بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وله. Do you have any question? Go ahead, inshallah. Ahmed asking about when you stand up from Rukua. The Imam says, Sami Allahu liman hamida. That's for the Imam. About you as a follower, what do you have to say? Do you have to say, to repeat again, Sami Allahu liman hamida? Then say, Rabbana wa laka alhamd, or Allahumma Rabbana laka alhamd, or just say, Rabbana wa laka alhamd, right away without repeating, Sami Allahu liman hamida. Is there any dispute between the scholars about this? Yes, there is a dispute between the scholars. Some scholars say you have to repeat privately, quietly, as a follower, as a ma'moom, Sami Allahu liman hamida, Rabbana wa laka alhamd. Other scholar, which is more authentic, at least in my opinion, more authentic for the Imam, he should say Sami Allahu liman hamida, and the ma'moom not repeating Sami Allahu liman hamida. More authentic to just say ربنا ولك الحمد or اللهم ربنا لك الحمد. But as long as we have different opinion between the scholar, if you hear someone beside you, next to you, as a follower like you, saying سمع الله الحمد, do not blame him, do not criticize him, because some scholars said that. But more authentic not to repeat سمع الله الحمد. فضل.
Inshallah. My question is, when I say سمع الله الحمد, Rabbana wa lakal hamd, hamdan kaseeran tayyiban mubarakan.
Good.
So can you tell me if I say what that means?
Yeah. One time the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leading the prayer, and when he says Sami'a Allahu liman hamida, one of the Sahaba said Rabbana wa lakal hamd, hamdan kaseeran tayyiban mubarakan fi. ملء السماوات وملء الأرض وملء ما شئت من شيء بعد أهل الثناء والمجد أحق ما قال العبد وكلنا لك عبد. All of this يعني statement. فالبروف محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't tell them before to say that. Just سمع الله الحمد ربنا ولك الحمد. But this was اجتهاد from one of the صحابة. And Prof. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم asked them, who said that? Who said this new statement? All of them became afraid to announce or to say. After Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam repeated three times, who said that? The person, that Sahabi who said that, said, I said that. And he felt يعني, ashamed. He felt that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will criticize or blame him. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do that. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, after you said that, tens of angels of Malaika was competing with each other, which one of them will write it first in your record. Tens of malaika. It has a great reward if you can say it has a. So it became from the sunnah, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved. It became from the sunnah if you can, and if you have time. To say after Rabbana wa laka alhamd, to say Rabbana wa laka alhamd, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fi, many thanks, unlimited thanks and praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the general meaning of that statement, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fi. If you can say it, it's from the sunnah, you'll get a great reward. More than 37 in some narrations. Angels will compete with each other who will write it down for you first.
Exactly.
Like it. Sure.
What's the difference between Tahara and Wudu?
What's the difference between Tahara and Wudu? Very clearly, Wudu part of the Tahara. Tahara more general. than wudu. Wudu just part, piece or part of the tahar. That's the. Well, like we نسمي الوضوء ال ال ممكن تسمى طهارة صغرى الوضوء. إنما الغسل سواء من جنابة أو غسل عام بصفة عامة على سبيل السنة طهارة كبرى. ولذلك الوضوء يزيل الحدث الأصغر، بينما الغسل يزيل الحدث الايه الأكبر اللي هو الجنابة. فالوضوء minor طهارة، غسل having a shower with the good intention that you have غسل according to the sunnah of beloved Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's major طهارة. Major tahar. So wudu, part of the tahar. ما عشان كده هي أعم، مش فقط بالماء. الطهارة برضو مش شاملة بس الطهارة بالمية، لا، طهارة من كل نجاسة. نعم. No. Brother Ala asked about the ayah. Which Allah said in that about the Quran or about Lawh al-Mahfuz, لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. No one touch it except the مطهرون, the most purified creatures. Does it mean it's haram to touch the Quran if you do not have wudu, or not haram? In this ayah, and the scholar said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't talk about the Mus'haf. He's not talking about the Mus'haf. He's talking about Lawh al-Mahfuz. اللوح المحفوظ. And he's talking about the angels, الملائكة. The most purified creature ever, الملائكة. They are only the creature who can touch or see اللوح المحفوظ. Not the human being, not the jinn. فالله سبحانه وتعالى does not talk about the مصحف. But still, يعني it's not haram to touch the Quran, to hold the Quran, to read the Quran. Even if you do not have wudu, it's not haram. But which is much better? We agreed it's not haram, but which is much better? To have wudu before you recite Quran or not to have wudu? Definitely to have wudu. You will get more reward. But it's not haram. والمؤمن لا ينجس. The mu'min, the believer, will never be najis. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. It's not haram to read the Quran even if you do not have wudu. But do your best, much better always, to have wudu before you read Quran. But if someone did not make wudu and he recited the Quran, it's okay. I cannot say it's haram for him. من هذا الباب ومن باب الأدب مع الله ومن باب الأدب مع كتاب الله. It's much better but not mandatory. الحمد لله. نعم. المهم لا يعمم على غيره على سبيل ان ياخذ اجر زياده ولا ينقص اجر غيره. يعني انت اجتهدت ولا لا وقلت حمد اخر بصيغه اخرى. ما دام انا مخليها لنفسي وبعد ما قلت الاشياء الثابته عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما استبدلهاش بشيء ثابت والا كده دخلت برضه في باب المخالفه. فما قلتلكش يا احمد لما تيجي ترفع من الركوع قول مثل ما انا بقول علشان تاخذ اجر زياده. كده يبقى بالله. انما لو انا brother احمد اسك about if someone else after the death of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is not with us physically. If someone made ijtihad and he said new statement while he's praying, not from the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, like that sahabi. The sahabi said new statement, but Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم approved it because he was alive at this time. How about nowadays, if someone from the Ma'mumin followers add new dhikr, new hamd, new statement in the prayer, can you consider it bid'ah and haram? No. Why not? We will consider it bid'ah in certain case, specific case. If someone invented new statement and starting telling other people, all people say the same what I'm saying in the prayer to get more reward. If someone did that and said that, it's bid'ah and it's haram because he's inventing reward and hasanat and tashri' other than or violated or not from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if someone just said that new statement, new tasbih, new tahmid, and he kept it for himself, he did not invite others, just for himself, I cannot say it's bid'ah. As long as he's saying good words, not bad words. As long as he's praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making salah over the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, saying tasbih, that's fine. لماذا؟ لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال عن الصلاة كلها إنما الصلاة دعاء وذكر وتسبيح وتحميد لله عز وجل، لا يحل فيها الكلام. فهو الصلاة بصفة عامة هي عبارة عن ذكر وحمد وتسبيح لله. المهم قول النبي قاله، وبعد كده لو عندك وقت وعايز تقول شيء طيب أنت يعني يريحك بشيء طيب، ولا تدعو الناس إليك سنة لم ترد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أنت حر في ذلك. As long as you are saying what the Prophet Muhammad said, all what he said, and you add something, some new statement, which is good, not bad, and you did not invite other, call upon us, other people to copy or imitate or follow you to get more reward, I cannot say it's bid'ah at all. Now, follow. When we can say about something it's halal, definitely halal, or haram, definitely. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said directly it's haram to do, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَمُ، لفظ حرام، كلمة حرام. Or Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said it's haram to do something, or من الكبائر، from the major sin to do something. Or another form, if Allah سبحانه وتعالى in the Quran or Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in the Sunnah commanded us to do something and there is no other dalil at all reduce that commandment to be Sunnah or to be lower than mandatory act of worship. Let's say مثلا وأقيموا الصلاة وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة. This is in the Quran. And Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded us to make إقامة للصلاة, to pray, the 5-day prayer. Is there any other ayah, any other hadith reduced the أقيموا الصلاة from being mandatory to be sunnah or mandub or mustahab? Is there any other ayah said, والله إقامة الصلاة, it's up to you. Is there any ayah said that? Or any hadith? So we have to understand and consider أقيم الصلاة as mandatory, obligatory. And still other forms of الأوامر والنواهي الشرعية. نعم. الله يكرمك. He mentioned another example about having beard. In the Quran, Allah سبحانه وتعالى did not command us to have beard or not to have beard. He just told us about some prophets. They used to have beard like Harun. لا تأخذ بلحيتي ولا برأسي. لكن Allah سبحانه وتعالى in the Quran did not command us in the Quran directly or indirectly to have a beard. But in the Sunnah, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded us to have beard. And he warned us from shaving the beard. But this commandment considered as a mandatory, obligatory, or sunnah? Because we have another hadith, authentic hadith. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned the having beard while he's mentioning cutting clipping your nails, sunnah al-fitra, shaving the hair in your private part. The scholar had dispute. The three imams, Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad Muhammad, understood that as an obligatory. You have to, every Muslim male, mature male, has to have beard. And it will be haram not to have it intentionally, without a necessity. Imam Shafi'i understood this commandment as preferable. It's preferable to have a beard. And it's makruh not to have a meal. Because he looked to other statement of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have these two opinions. The opinion of some great scholar considered wajib, mandatory, and another valid and authentic opinion related to Imam Shafi'i, for instance. That one of the scholars, there are other scholars, consider that having beard is sunnah and not mandatory, not obligatory. So you have to keep to these opinions, alhamdulillah. تفضل. علي صوتك لو سمحت.
اللي فهمته انه عدم الحق كلهم يتفقون على عدم الحق. فيعني
على عدم الحق على انه ايه حكمه ايه؟
بالموس يعني.
لا اقصد اللي يحلف بالموس اتفقوا على الحكم ايه؟
كلهم اتفقوا انه محرم.
لا هذا لم يحصل. برضه الثلاث ائمه ابو حنيفه وابن حنبل والامام مالك قالوا حرام. ما لم يكن فيه ضرورة طبعا، الضرورات يبيح المحظورات، إنما لما فيه ضرورة. الإمام الشافعي ومن تبع مذهبه الإمام النووي والإمام المنذري في الترغيب والترهيب، هتجد حتى عنوان الباب كده استحباب إطلاق اللحية وكراهية حلقها، ده في كتب الشافعي، ابتداء من الشافعي نفسه في كتاب الأم، مرورا بكتب الإمام النووي كلها وكتب الإمام المنذري وبالذات الترغيب والترهيب. Not all the scholars agreed upon one حكم for the لحية. As I mentioned, we have two different authentic opinions. And you are free to follow any one of them. I'm with the opinion, as long as you do not have necessity or valid excuse not to have a beard, you should have it. But if you believe that you have a valid excuse or a necessity prevent you from having a beard, if you do not have this excuse, you should have it. If any Muslim has this valid excuse, he can follow the Imam Shafi'i.
How many hadith sahih came for the year?
No, exactly how many? I don't know how many, but many hadith.
Sahih.
All of them are sahih.
I want to grow in the year.
Are our having you? No. But what's the understanding of that? Is it mandatory? Can all the ulama understood as mandatory, obligatory? Not all of them. Part of them said it's mandatory, other parts said it's preferable.
نهي
امر في اصول الفقه كده والكلام طويل.
فك الشارع
واعف الله.
هذا مو امر
هذا؟ هذا امر، لكن ورد صيغ اخرى تقلل، ده كلام ما شافعي، تخفض الامر ان يكون للفرض ومخالفه التحريم الى ان يكون الامر للاستحباب ومخالفه للكراهه التنزيهيه. ده في علم اصول الفقه. أصول فقه الشافعية مختلفة عن أصول فقه الحنابلة والأحناف والمالكية، فدول فهموا بهذه الطريقة رضي الله عنهم، وهؤلاء فهموا بهذه الطريقة. الحمد لله. وإتس رحمة، إتس رحمة from Allah to us that we have great scholars had different opinions. It's great mercy from Allah to us. الحمد لله. Otherwise it would be haram for more than 95% of Muslim men. الحمد لله. طب هو كان احمد عايز يقول سؤال وانت As long as we have disputes between the scholars, many opinion, and all of these opinion are authentic, so as a much better from if you are wise enough, as Allah commanded us to be wise, not to create fitna. As long as we have different opinions, but if something, all the scholars agreed upon one hukm for it without any dispute, without any different opinion, all of us have to follow. But as long as the scholar themselves had these disputes and different opinion, so alhamdulillah, we are free to follow any opinion and do not create any fitna. Do not make our relationship bad relationship because of these disputes. Alhamdulillah.
Is this such a hadith in the Rasul Allah?
Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, مش الرسول نفسه. Abdullah, Sayyidina Abdullah, the son of Umar ibn Khattab, used to cut anything extra other than his
handful.
His fist, yeah. Anything extra, he used to cut it, especially when he make tahallul from Hajj or from Umrah. Abdullah ibn Umar, not Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you still have the choice to follow, and much better طبعاً, to follow the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Much better. But follow him as a mandatory in the matter of lihya or as a sunnah, you have these two opinions, alhamdulillah.
Rasulullah didn't cut his beard at all.
I do not know any hadith about that. Yeah, there is, as far as I know, I have never read any hadith telling me that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cut his beard. I have never read it. بس لأن النبي ذكرها فخرج من قبيل العادة لأن الإمام الشيخ مزهر قال إنها من العادات مخالفة لله.
نعم.
لكنها أصلا يعني لا تصل إلى الفرض وأقصى ما تصل إليه السنة. نعم. It was a custom for the Arab people to have beard for the male and wearing the imama and qamis. It was a custom, a habit for them, more than a religious issue. But because Prophet Muhammad mentioned these things, it became sunnah. You will get reward if you do that. Yeah. But if Prophet Muhammad didn't mention them at all, it's just custom and habit for the Arab people. Now, جزاكم الله خيرا سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته